that you please move forward. For those of us who have come in early, let's occupy the front seats. Just leave the first two rows empty, but we can, from the third rows down, please ushers, let's usher people in. Rise to our feet, even as we take the opening prayer.
Needs to find a place.
church will say amen. We welcome you to this evening of tributes for our dearly beloved Dr. Myles and Pastor Ruth Munroe. We do not mourn as though we have no hope, but we've come to celebrate the life of this dear couple. And so I want you to please reach out to a neighbor and just welcome them and wish them a greeting, a sign of peace. This is a celebration of life. And you may please be seated in God's presence. The Bible says our times are in God's hands.
You don't have to worry, and don't you be afraid.
King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. You will be remembered for what you have done. And this evening, we're remembering Dr. Myles and Pastor Ruth Munroe for the purposeful lives they bind. Can we please rise to our feet? It will be projected on the screen.
Hallelujah. We may please be seated. I've been asked to read the biography of this great man and woman of God, the biography of Dr. Myles and Pastor Ruth Munroe. Dr. Myles Munroe was born on 20th April 1954. Nassau, Bahamas. He grew up poor in a family of of 11 children. He graduated with degrees in fine arts, education, and theology from Oral Roberts University in 1978 at the age of 24. He obtained a master's degree in administration from the University of Tulsa in 1980 at the age of 26 and received several honorary doctorate degrees from various institutions. He was the founder and president of Bahamas Faith Ministries International, an all-encompassing network of ministries with headquarters in Nassau, Bahamas. He served as the senior pastor of BFM International Fellowship, one of the largest churches in Bahamas. He was also the chairman of the board of the International Third World Leaders Association, an all-professional global network of leaders focusing on formal leadership development and training primarily in developing nations. Dr. Myles was a multi-gifted international motivational speaker, best-selling author, and business consultant to governments, Fortune 500 companies, and corporations, addressing the critical issues that affect every aspect of human, professional, leadership, social, and spiritual development. He has written over 38 books, many of which are bestsellers, such as Becoming a Leader, The Spirit of Leadership, The Principles and Power of Vision, The Pursuit of Purpose, Rediscovering the Kingdom, Understanding Your Potential, Releasing Your Potential, God's Big Idea, In Charge, among many others. He was married to his wife, Pastor Ruth Ann Munroe, who served as a co-pastor with him at BFMI. They were blessed with two children, Cairo Myles Jr. and Carissa. Dr. Myles was transited to glory with his wife and seven others on 9th of November 2014, he lived a purposeful life of impact and service to God and humanity. God bless you all.
Next, we want to take two documentaries on the life and times of Dr. Myles Munroe. Are we on cue? Okay.
Dr. Myles Munroe, a general of the Lord's army, one of the few men whose gift and vision were in equilibrium, transforming followers into leaders and leaders into agents of change. He practiced what he preached as he applied his knowledge on the word to his life as he grew.
I am from a family of 11 children. I am number 6. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Oh, I'm back home in City of David, my favorite church. I love you so much that every year I want to come here. And I keep telling my wife the best church in Nigeria is the City of David.
He blessed the world with his exceptional teaching.
The Bible says that a woman builds her house with her hands, but tears it down with her mouth. All the men say, mm-hmm. So women, if you want to be blessed, just shut up.
Make people greater than yourself, and you will live forever. They will call your name every day.
A person with character doesn't seek promotion. God promotes them because he can trust them.
There's some things you want God to do, but you ain't willing to pay a price. I'm not telling you I'm fasting because I want you to think I'm impressing you. I wanted to show you what 21 days of food looks like, because most of the people I meet in the church, when they fast for 2 days, they think they're going to die. That's a lie. If you can't overcome the power of your belly, how can you overcome the power of a demon?
I want you to go to the grave completely empty. It is God's will that you die empty.
I speak prophetically that we are now about to enter in the next few days a period of what I call the last moment. From July 2014 to July 2015, there shall be tremendous
back at Christ Church. I've been here many times, and I've been a part of this church history. I've been here since 8 years ago. It's good to be back again, and I look into your faces, and I see that you are continuing to grow in the faith. You got one of the greatest pastors in this whole country. Pastor Remy is a blessing. Please give him a hand, and his lovely wife. What a blessing to have both of them.
Life is very short. I don't have much time on earth. So every minute of my life I have come to cherish, and everything I do with that minute has become a priority. The only thing worse than death is life without purpose. It is better to be dead and not have to worry about living than to live and not know why.
The value of life is not in its duration, but its donation. You are not important because of how long you live. You are important because of how effective you live. I always tell people my greatest motivator is death. When I think about my death, it makes me work hard. And death has been placed in my life as a timing. Matter of fact, the next verse of that chapter says, there's a time to be born and a time to die. In other words, you got to know that there's a time you're supposed to die, and you're supposed to complete your assignment before you die. And if you die before you complete your assignment, you were killed.
So great leaders measure their greatness by their absence. My question is, if you die today,
si tú te mueres
as a leader,
como líder,
leaving the studio
dejando
in an accident,
accident,
what happens to your organization?
¿Qué pasa con
what happens to your church?
¿Qué pasa
what happens
con
to your business?
¿Qué pasa con tu negocio?
If it dies,
si muere,
when you die,
cuando tú mueres,
you are a failure.
Eres un fracasado.
So I encourage you right now.
Te animo ahora mismo.
Identify your successors.
Identifica aquellos que te van a seguir
and
a ti después.
Mentor them.
Y entrénalos.
And train them.
Entrénalos.
This is why,
es por eso que
in our organization,
en nuestra organización,
I am unnecessary.
Yo no soy necesario allí.
I can travel the world.
Yo puedo viajar por todo el mundo.
And our ministry grows.
Y nuestro ministerio
the companies
crece.
Grow.
La compañía crece.
My son,
mi hijo,
who is 29 years old,
que tiene 29 años de edad,
is running my businesses.
Él corre mis negocios.
My daughter,
mi hija,
who is 30,
que tiene 30,
is running our global organization.
Ella maneja toda la, nuestra organización global.
Why? I mentored them.
Yo la,
what happened?
¿Qué pasa?
In your absence.
En tu ausencia.
That's your legacy.
Eso es tu legado.
Don't die old, die empty. As a matter of fact, one of the greatest statements I ever heard about dying is this statement. I think it's a beautiful statement of dying. It says, it is finished. Three words. The guy who said that was only 33 years old, he didn't say, I was finished. Because we don't die, we are eternal spirits. He says, it is finished. I like the Apostle Paul who said, I have finished my course. I have kept the faith. I have been poured out like a drink offering. There's nothing left. I am ready to die. Praise, praise, praise the Lord. We can do better than that. Praise the Lord. Please, can we have the lights on, please? Amen. Now, if you are not encouraged by that, I don't know what can encourage you. I tell people, he can't die. Dr. Myles can't die. Not with all the materials we have everywhere. Not with all the publications and the various video materials
here and there. Amen. Praise the Lord. I don't like the way he said something. He said he would get up from his grave. You want him to come up? Hallelujah. And you know, as he was saying about the dress code, I looked at myself. Amen. And then I consoled myself that there's a touch of red and touch of white. Praise God. So look at your neighbor and just tell them, I hope you are dressed appropriately. We don't want him rising from the grave now, do we? Amen. Hallelujah. In whatever situation we find ourselves, God is sovereign, he is king, and still on the throne. Hallelujah. Amen. I don't know about you, but I don't want Dr. Myles to come visit us now. Thank you, choir. Let's give them a round of applause. You know, like someone said, if you had the privilege of raising the dead, you'll probably run away. Just think about it. You pray for someone out of faith or out of duty, and then the person sneezes. What do you think will happen? Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. We want to take tributes and testimonies, and we want to throw it open before we call on someone who will give a prepared tribute. Is there anyone here? Is someone who touched almost everybody in Christendom and beyond? Amen. And I'm sure you all agree with me that when the news broke, all of us had a personal, it seems as if it was part of us, everybody. I remember the first time I got to know of Pastor Myles Munroe, I walked in a few years ago, roughly maybe 20 years ago, I walked into one of these places where you make phone calls, international phone calls, and my wife and I entered that place. And there was this guy who was trying to call, apparently, what was Bahamas. He was putting a call through to Bahamas. And he said, I want to, is that Myles Munroe? Is that Myles Munroe? And I told my wife, I said, what's wrong with this guy? He said, oh, Myles Munroe. Praise God. Amen. So can we have hands up? Anyone here who would like to give a testimony? Yes, we have one hand there. We have another. We'll just take three before we take. Yes, please, can you come forward? First person, and then we have another hand there. Just walk forward, please, so that we can. Please, 2 minutes. A personal encounter.
Praise the Lord. I think it was 2001 or two. Peculiar People's Ministry brought him to Ibadan. And he said a lot. And then I was a minister already, but I was just yet to get a job. But he made some profound statements, just like he was saying. But part of it was, prepared me before I got a job. He talked about investment. He explained the light that shines upon the earth. Jesus lighting everyone. You're here on assignment. That assignment is the most important thing. Your marriage was to be controlled by it. So the purpose selects for you to marry amongst many. I was going to get married. I was just going to get a job. So immediately I got my job. It was very simple. In fact, before I got married, I remember those statements he used to say, if you knew who it was that was sitting by you, you would take me to dinner. I remember I used to tell my wife to be then that you don't know who I am. If you knew who I was, I mean, you will leave all these guys. But truly, he transformed my life. And I can't mention in detail because, you know, he used to say, you can be alone. No, you can be single but not alone. Before I got married, I had solid investment. Such that it was like when I saw my mates, I was up there. But they didn't know because you wouldn't say what it was. But years later, I will hardly preach in church without looking back to that 2001, 2002. I actually got into ministry 2000 when Pastor Gandhi brought him to Ibadan in Jesus Embassy Family. It has changed my life, changed the people I came with. That I remember in our church now, about almost three young people. One is already building, is yet to get married. Because the same way he prepared me, I tried to prepare so many. He has transformed my life.
Thank you very much. Amen.
Praise the Lord. 1994, I went to a video rental shop, and I got this video of the Azusa conference, and I settled down with my senior brother, Pastor Dupsi, and we both watched that program that night. We couldn't sleep. The whole of the night, we watched that video about 4 or 5 times. And then the next day or 2 days after, we said, we need to give this to Pastor Tony to also take a look at, because we're in Freedom Hall then, you know. And for me, it was overwhelming and mind-blowing. That was a point in my life. I was just under 30, and I was wondering, is there more to life than the work, than, you know? I was asking for purpose. And he just clearly defined it, you know, and that was life transforming for me. There are significant milestones in my life that have been touched by Dr. Myles Munroe. When I thought about leadership, I read the book Spirit of Leadership. I've talked about it in church. I've preached, I've shared about it in secular trainings. And that really also transformed my life. Today I have all his books. I've read, probably 7 out of 8 of them, you know. My library is full of his books. Not just one copy, but even 2 copies of some, you know. And he was with us in March, just before his 60th. He was invited to take a session of the leadership in the organization I work in March. And we were there celebrating his 60th, which was about to happen. And the whole of the management team was just shocked by what they heard. You know, everyone was, it was like a mind-blowing experience. You know, and that's the way he's touched lives. And as he even left, you know, I was among the 3 people that saw him off. And he looked at me and he said, I'd like to give you this. And he passed the lapel pin on his hand, which was on his jacket, and he just said, take this and just have it, you know. And for me, that was really, really touching. When I heard he passed on, it was like, wow, you mean he's just gone like that? I didn't recognize that was the last time that I would actually meet him physically. I want to thank God for his life. Thank God for his wife. She stood by him through everything, you know, and he always celebrated his children, Cairo and Carissa. And for me, for the ministry God has committed to my hands, it is largely because of what he has done in my life that I've been able to also contribute a bit to the work. Thank you.
This year, I was invited to a program, and I remember Pastor Idi and some other people too were there. I think National Transformation Institute. And it was at a co-hotel, if I remember correctly. He opened up our minds to something so profound. He talked about the land. He talked so much about the land and the Bible that it was all about the land. And that if we look around in Israel, the Jews, they do not sell their land. They can lease it for 99 years, 100 and something years, but you can build anything you want, but it will come back to you. And I remember that I was looking round the hall that day, and everybody, I think they were shocked with what he said, because he opened our hearts, you know, in depth to a lot of things that we never really thought about. And for me, I remember that when I left, I took a lot of notes, and I typed so much, and I gave it to quite a number of my friends that you need to read this. And I remember that there was another meeting we went for, Doing was there, and I talked about it, that there was something I witnessed, and it was so profound. It opened my eyes to so many other things about a lot of things that we do. So for me, that experience, we've had a lot of experiences with him, but that was, I, that, what it was all about, except you were there that day. So what can I say but just to say we bless God for his life and we pray that the good works that he has left will continue. In Jesus' name.
Praise the Lord. Praise the name of Jesus. I'd just like to read, you know, something that I had written. I had sent to one of his mentees the day after I had heard about, you know, this tragedy. What had occurred was just a few days before we heard the news, there was something I read on the internet where someone said, we are all just a moment away from death. Just a moment away from death. So I realized that this, unfortunately, is the reality of life. Pastor Shego spoke about some video. Did Pastor Tony eventually show that video in church? I think he might have, because that was my first encounter with Dr. Myles. And it was shown in his church, and he was teaching. And you know, when you see those videos, some of these folks seem so far away. But subsequently for me, you know, I got into Christian bookselling and would show up at the booksellers' conventions, and Dr. Myles would be there, maybe as guest minister to promote some of his books. And I found it so disarming, his attitude. This is this individual you've seen in the videos, and then you meet with him one-on-one, and he really just is at everyone's level. He started coming to Nigeria. We hosted him a couple of times at book signings at Lertana, and he would come in, you know, chat with everybody. He was just so down to earth. This conference that took place, that he died, Pastor Eddie, we were there, I think it was about 10 years ago. So we attended the conference, and then on one of those evenings, he took us to his house, and we're at the back porch of this man's house, you know, maybe about 15, 20 of us, you know, just having drinks and little bits to eat. We went in and out of his house. I don't know, maybe there are just a few cars parked in front, but that was just the nature of this huge giant that the Lord has raised. I say we mourn the transition of a giant, an inspirer of our faith, and a remarkable agent of transformation. The grace upon his life in these fairs was translating to so much impact all over the world, and especially within Nigeria, as different state governments and organizations were opening up to receive not just his message, but also his mentoring. The body of Christ certainly will miss him sorely. He's always said that success without succession was really failure. And I took those words to heart. And for me, whenever I traveled out of the country, I was away from my office, I used that statement as an index to measure, did the guys perform better in my absence or not? And whenever they did, I came back to say, hey, you're working well. At the INC conference, I was the chairman of the local organizing committee. He was there last year. One of the events was one at Eco Hotel. And then we hosted him at Sheba Event Center. And on one of those sessions, he spoke so extensively about succession. He says that when we're in a race, your assignment is to run your leg of the relay race. There is a box within which you must hand over the baton and the next person receive the baton. And he literally displayed it. He got people outside to literally hand over baton to somebody else. And he said to us that, you know, as far as he's concerned, he has handed over his business to his son, Kari. He's introduced him to all his bankers, introduced him to, you know, the real estate agents, he's introduced him to his publishers. He has done all of that. And there were a few things he said about the obligation of leadership. He says, transfer your deposit to the next generation. Success is measured by the success of your successor. Leadership is a sprint. It's not a sprint, but a marathon relay. He says, as a runner in the third leg, will you release the baton to the runner on the last leg? He says, in Africa, the average age of our leaders is 75, that they don't want to hand over the baton, unfortunately. Amen? Praise the name of the Lord. But I take solace in his message and how it has been received. You know, the day after it occurred, they said that they were going to go ahead with that conference, with the leadership conference, because they know that that is what Dr. Myles would have wanted. And they went ahead with that conference. I think it was at the close of the conference that his son, you know, shared what it was that we're listening to. for me, if I wanted to study a subject, after reading what the Bible would say about it, I would pick up Dr. Miles' book on the purpose and power of glory, the purpose and power of man, purpose and power of praise and worship. There was just always something else that he would add. So physically, he's not here. But I have no doubt at all that he remains alive via the numerous books that he has, via his messages, via the DVDs. And I pray that each and all of us will continue to take inspiration from that. He has run his race. The last video we listened to was shared about 3 weeks before he died at a conference in Kenya. And he says, I have run my race. I have finished my course. And I think the charge for us that were direct, indirect mentees that received his message is to run with what it is that he has shared. He challenged us to find purpose. He challenged us to understand the role of leadership, the role of mentoring, the role of succession. And I think that's the assignment that each and every one of us has. And I trust that the Lord will help us actualize that in Jesus' name.
Praise the Lord. First of all, Dr. Myles Munroe affected my life and life of my family in things he did, things he didn't do. He didn't have to say anything, but he just affected our lives. Like, being at the City of David, I know the first time my family ever heard of the City of David, we used to live in Delta State. My parents had business to do in Lagos, and they came and they heard Myles Munroe was going to be at the City of David. They didn't know where it was, but they just knew they had to find a place, and then they found City of David. They didn't know that a time in their life will come where we will have to move to Lagos and City of David will eventually become our church. But it was just because Myles Munroe was coming, so they came to City of David. And that was the first thing he did, which of course he didn't know he did for us. And City of David has really been a blessing to my family. Because it was at a very, I won't say tragic moment, but a very hard time for my family that we found City of David. And as I have said, they've been a blessing, a very big blessing to us. Myles Munroe. The first time I met him in person was when he was here on a Tuesday, and he spoke about marriage, a lot of things about marriage that day, and I was sitting down somewhere there, and he said, you can be alone, but you're not lonely. I really thought of it. I'm like, true. This thing made sense, because all of my friends wanted to have girlfriends. They needed a girl to stand beside them because they felt they were lonely. When he said that, I'm like, this is true. You don't need a girl to be with you to enjoy yourself. And since then, it has just been my principle. When people just ask me, do you have a girlfriend? I'm like, no. They're like, why? Because I don't need one. It's that simple. And they're surprised. But it was because I attended the service that day. I could really understand it. And I remember that day, I would have missed the service because my school, I was supposed to be in school by Monday, but I and my brother decided to stay till Tuesday so we would meet him. And it was worth it. It was worth it. Not only that, after the service, I told myself, this man of God, I have to just touch him, just meet him, handshake, something. I thought of it like the woman with the issue of blood. Honestly, because I had a lot of challenges at the moment, and I just felt that this great man of God, I just needed a touch. So what I did, I was here. Immediately the service was over. I knew he would live through that door. I ran all the way, quick. I got there. He wasn't there. And I'm like, oh no, he's already gone into the office. boys, how was the service? And I looked, Myles Munroe, I'm like, this must be God. And he just shook my brother, and I said, no, you must shake me too. And I stretched my hand, and he shook me, and I said, yes, this is God. And after that, of course, I had exams, was successful. I don't know if it was the touch, but something happened. And when I heard just now, who was I heard tribute, so I thought it was maybe some specific people. Once they said it was open, I put my hand up. I must speak. Because being here, being in the city of David, was Myles Munroe. I won't lie to anybody. And the day I heard the news, I was the first person in my family who figured it out, because I was just on Facebook and I saw it and I'm like, no, this is not true. This can't be true. And when I figured out, I had to go on the internet, I checked, I saw it was true. My brother was beside me, about to sleep. But I said, no, if I tell him now, he won't be able to sleep. My mom was about to go to bed too. I said, if I tell her, she'll be able to sleep. So I kept the news. I slept, I couldn't even sleep. They all slept. In the morning, she was going out. And I said, is it time to tell her? And then I told her, she was so broken, she couldn't even move. And we're like, this man had been like a father to us, although he wasn't at our house. And especially for her, my brother. Because we had lost our dad. So Myles Munroe had been a father to us. Able to talk about him and all he's done for me. I know he's in a better place where God wants him to be. And I believe that one day I'll be there with him. Amen.
Next, we'll take from the representative of Peculiar People's Management, Ms. Kikelomo Atonda Owo. Let's welcome her.
I'm very nervous. I'm grateful for the opportunity to stand before you all. I thank Pastor Haide and his beautiful wife and the pastor. My name is Kikeloma Sondao. I work with PPM, Peculiar People Management. PPM represents Dr. Myles Munroe for the past 10 years. His death was a shock to us. He inspired my CEO, Pastor Gandhi Olaoye Afolabi, to start PPM, and he has supported us from the beginning to date. It has been a good experience working closely with him, and our CEO blessed the day he met him. We say good night to our bosom friend, our spiritual father, our mentor, teacher, and legendary icon. I believe nothing is more important than a man's legacy. I would like to end with one of his favorite quotes that says that the greatest tragedy in life is to live a life without purpose. And I would like to share my experience, the last prayer he gave me before he passed. Many times when it comes to Nigeria, I'm always with him with my other
gentleman, but very humorous and very loving. My honeysuckle would make you laugh. He says, he's the one man that kisses him. Because he will hug him tight and kiss him and kiss him and kiss him. That was Dr. Myles for you. He will kiss you. But having said that, Dr. Myles is teaching us even in death. He's teaching us Christians to be prepared for the eventuality. And the thing that is most important is being prepared to die. Dr. Myles, where you are, we know you are with the Lord. We thank God for a wonderful life. We thank God for a life truly well spent. We thank God for an inspiring life. But we keep saying, Dr. Myles, Dr. Myles. Dr. Myles had a wife, Mrs. Ruth Munroe. She passed away also in this plane crash. And I don't think Dr. Myles could be all he was meant to be if he did not have the support of this gentlewoman. I found it very funny the first time I met them that here was a man whose character was larger than life. Not only that, he was somebody you would love easily. And standing by him was a very quiet woman. Very quiet. It takes a lot of grace to be quiet and be with somebody for so many years and not competing. She was not in competition with him. She celebrated him. To you, my dear sister, Mrs. Ruth Munroe, we thank God for your life. We thank God that you stood by him. And when it was time to go, the way you stood by him was the way the Almighty God decided to take you. We bless God. And I don't know if it is possible for you to rise up with me and just say, well done. Well done, good and faithful servants of the Almighty God. Well done, true Christian soldiers of the cross. Well done, giants of faith. Well done, Ruth and Myles Munroe. The Lord will receive you even in his abode in Jesus' mighty name.
Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Amen and amen. Praise the Lord. We'll take our next song. The Lord is King.
Thank you. But in the midst of my soul.
give a shout of praise? Can somebody give a shout of praise? God gives his children a song in the night. Reference Psalm 42, verse 8. Choir.
The heavens resounded in songs. The angels cry, holy, 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 in harmony around the great white throne. But then Adam fell from the garden. Oh, Satan thought it won the victory. Then Jesus came all the way from glory, just to give us a reason to sing. Come and sing, sing hallelujah. Is the joy of our salvation. Hallelujah. Glory to the Holy One.
Say
hallelujah. Every tongue and every nation. God gives his children a song.
Sing it again.
God gives his children a song. From the dawning of all creation, the angels resounded in song. The angels cry, holy, 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 in harmonies around the great white throne. But then Adam fell from the garden. Oh, Satan thought it won the victory. But Jesus came all the way from glory, just to give us a reason to sing. Come and sing.
Sing hallelujah.
It's the joy of our salvation.
Hallelujah.
Glory to the Holy One.
Say
hallelujah.
Every tongue and every nation. My God gives his children a song.
Sing it again.
God gives his children a song.
One more time.
God gives his children a song.
Hey. Hey. Assured that God will not send Dr. Myles back. Amen. had such a remarkable ministry. I call his ministry a crossover ministry, not only received at the church, but outside the church also, in government circles, even in government circles in Nigeria. He had held training programs for quite a number of state governments, including the governors. We want to take a testimony from that constituency within this country, and I'd like to call on Ambassador Aminu Wisdom to please come and give a tribute. Let's welcome him as he comes.
Praise God. Hallelujah. Praise God. It's a very difficult moment for us. When you want to speak about someone who have impacted your life and turned you around, even when you thought you were truly lost, it's difficult to speak about it. Particularly when you feel and you know so well that you may not see him again. My own particular experience was dated back 2007 when I was first appointed the Nigerian ambassador to ECOWAS Commission. That was a very big challenge for me because, and that's actually the first assignment I was committed to, and I was lost, and I went to see my father in the Lord. I asked him, how do I go about this? He reached out to his drawer and brought out two books. They were written by Dr. Myles Munroe. And he said he won't say anything to me. When I finish reading them, I come back to tell him what I contacted from those books. To cut a long story short, from those books, from those two books, was the fundamental principle that built the office I run today for this nation. Anytime we are going for our presentation, I bring those two books out. When I'm putting together my speech or any address I'm to put together, I cite it, they were my authorities. And there's nowhere I ever go to, either at the beginning of my speech or at the end of my speech, that the whole hall will not be upside down, all to the glory of God. They were the principal arrow and the trade secret with which we are running that office today, including my family. So when it happened, I called on my big brother, Pastor Remy. I told him, I said, look, we need to do something. I'm looking at the bigger picture of it because I've taken a step further. I've personally written to the president of this country requesting him to kindly immortalize Dr. Myles Munroe because he's bigger than what we are here for. There are too many policies that we have changed as a country as a reason of certain facts he has exposed to us as a nation. The way we run the Council of State, it made a tremendous impact in the way we run it today. And I'm happy with the kind of president we have. We have a listening ear and who is willing to make a change and accept responsibility at every point. I believe we still have to do something to get the government, both state governments, some ministers, there are many of my kind in the system today who believe so much on the principle that great man of God taught us. It's not just to the body of Christ alone, as well as to the secular, even in the banking industry. Before I got to this, I didn't know this was going to happen today. It was last minute information. commission I got. I said, okay, wherever Myles Munroe is going to... As a matter of fact, I was preparing to go to the Bahamas until I found out that it's strictly on invitation. And if you are not invited because of space and time and a whole lot of... I was ready and willing to go anywhere that they are going to send anybody, anywhere is going to be celebrated. That's why I'm here at the last minute. I tell you, it's a man that we will forever, never in this nation forget. He has done a lot. Things have changed in the way governments are run. I was privileged in the last United Nations General Assembly in September. He was there with us. It may interest you to know, before this, before every section, we have a leaders in a caucus meeting where he speaks to leaders, help them to understand how they should make their presentation. And I believe, as an organization, United Nations will miss him, because he's been the only one consistently handling that area since 2008 till date. It's a life to be celebrated. I have not come across any of his books that I have not found just one thing that will turn you around. He's a man of truth. I don't want to go dive into some personal experiences I have, because he moves me, he tickles me, because from that day he passed on till date, I have not been the same. Things have changed, but I take solemn from so many things he have said, that the only thing that we must know and that we cannot run away from is death. And what we must do is to ensure that we leave a legacy behind and pass it on to the ones following us. May the Lord continue to grant his family the strength to handle this difficult time. You can imagine, if we, from a distance, can feel this way, you can imagine what is going on there. It's a very difficult period. May the Lord give us understanding. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Ambassador. Amen. We keep on discovering more and more things about Dr. Myles. Amen. Praise the Lord. Next, we want to hear a short exhortation. And join me as I welcome Pastor I.D. Iluyomade.
Let's clap for Jesus. Let's celebrate the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, the I am that I am. Amen. The Lord of life. Please be seated. Please be seated. Heavenly Father, we want to thank you. We bless your holy name. Thank you, O Lord, because we know that in life, in death, you're still the Lord. We bless you. We pray that in the next few minutes you speak to your people. You encourage the church, the body of Christ. At the end of it all, take all the glory. Take all the honor. Take all the adoration. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Praise the Lord. Tonight's service was not put together so that we'll have long speeches. As it says, it's a night of tributes, a night of songs, celebrating a life of impact and service to God and to humanity. And I believe that through the songs that we have heard and the testimonies, God has already started speaking to each and every one of us. And I know that every one of us, we have our own levels of relationships with Dr. Myles and Pastor Ruth. He's been to many churches, ministered in various places, impacted and touched and transformed various lives through his teachings, his books, and the various CDs that we have on sale here. I think that one thing that you must do tonight, should do, is to make sure that you at least have one of his books. Many of us have been privileged to have him autograph, you know, some of his books. And the last meeting I had with him, he autographed this book, The Power of Character in Leadership, can see that he was still communicating. And that is why we thought it fit, and I thank God for the entire Apapa family, and especially Pastor Remy, also, who agreed that we should put these together, you know, because this man has impacted a lot of lives. And ever since we heard of his transition, there have been lots and loads and tons of questions. People are saying, why? Looking at the mode in which the Lord took him. And if you look at the whole scriptures, you see that a lot of paradoxes and things that you really can't unravel. The hidden things belong to God. It's the glory of God to hide some things. The ones that he reveals to us, yes, we know. But the Bible says that it is his glory to conceal some things. There are many questions that one would ask. Why were the apostles killed the way they were killed? Why was John the Baptist beheaded and Jesus was there, was around? How come Elijah went to heaven in a chariot of fire and Elisha, who had a double portion of his anointing, died of a sickness? Yet his bones brought a dead man to life. People of God, questions, questions, questions. The Bible says that his ways are past finding out, unsearchable. He does as he pleases. You know, people talk a lot about Job. Job went through a lot of horrors. There was a time the wife said, "Curse God and die so I can remarry." He didn't do that. And when you think of Job, you always remember that Job said, "Even if he slays me, yet will I trust him." But I found in the book of Job a scripture in Job 23, verse 2. Tonight, there we see that the greatest frustration of Job, and I think for better understanding, let's just read it. It says, "Even today is my complaint bitter. My stroke is heavier than my groaning. Oh, that I knew where I might find him." Talking about God. He had questions. "I'm a righteous man. How can all these things be happening? Am I come to even his seat?" Says, "I would order my cause before him and fill my mouth with arguments. I would know the words which he would answer me and understand what he would say unto me. Will he plead against me with his great power? No, but he will put strength in me. There the righteous might dispute with him. So should I be delivered forever from my judge. Behold, I go forward, he is not there. And backward, I can't even perceive him. On the left hand, where he doth walk, but I cannot behold him. He hideth himself on the right hand, that I cannot see him." He was looking for answers. He had questions. But God chose, at that point, not to answer him. By the time you get to chapter 42, 40 on, when God opened his mouth and answered me, I said, "Who are you to ask me these questions?" He said, "God, I'm sorry. Please forgive." He said, "God, no, I'm not done with you. Where were you when I created the heavens and the earth?" He regretted asking those questions. There are many, many questions that we have that we might not be able to answer. But one thing I know is that one of the lessons that we receive from the life of Dr. Myles and his wife is that it's very important to live a life that counts. A life that counts. A life that is impactful. A life of purpose. It's not about how long or how short. Our Lord and Master Jesus Christ, in the last 3.5 years, he died at 33. His legacy? Have we lived a life of impact? There's a difference between being successful and living a purposeful life. You can be successful. You can be climbing up the ladder only to find out at the end of the top of the ladder that your ladder is resting against the wrong wall. So it's not about being successful. It's about being living a life of purpose, a purposeful life, that which has been written by God for you and I. My prayer is that as you think over the life of Dr. Myles, we remember that he lived a life that counts. He left a living legacy. And my prayer is that every one of us will emulate this great man and woman of God. But for those that still have questions, well, the Bible says in Isaiah 57, 1 and 2, Isaiah 57, 1 and 2, it says, the righteous precious and no man layeth it to heart. And merciful men are taken away, none considering that the righteous is taken away from the evil to come. He shall enter into peace. They shall rest in their beds, each one walking in his unrighteousness, in his uprightness. God understands. He knows why. But my prayer is that we'll learn a lesson from these ones. They lived lives that count. One of the things he said in the video is that he should be celebrated at death, because it's like you recalling your ambassador for a reward for good works. Before I go, I'd like us to also celebrate our own very dear Pastor Gandhi, who God used to connect Dr. Myles to many of us. Let's just clap for Pastor Gandhi. Just clap for Pastor Gandhi. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Finally, if they ask any one of us, now would you rather live 100 years and something happens and you miss heaven? Or would you rather die now and heaven is guaranteed? I'm sure that those that have understanding would choose to die at the right time. Because the end of our faith is the salvation of our souls. What does it matter? What does it matter to gain the whole world and at the end of it all lose our soul? So as I leave this stage, I think one of the things that we need to think about is that we are sure that concerning Dr. Myles, the Bible says that to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. He's resting right now because he knew the Lord before he died. If you don't know the Lord before you die, if you don't know him as your personal Lord and Savior, when you die, you can't know him. It will be too late. People of God, that is why tonight, as all eyes are closed, there might be one or two of us that don't know Jesus Christ as their personal Lord and Savior. You have not accepted him publicly. You have not declared for him as your personal Lord and Savior. There's no way you can make it. It says, I'm the way, I'm the truth, I'm the life. The confidence that we have that whenever we die, we'll make it to heaven, lies in the fact that before we die, we're in a relationship with him. So, are you here? You have never publicly declared for him. You are not born again. Or you look at your life. If you die now, what will be said of you? Your life actually does not count. You are weighed and you are found wanting in the scale of God. But today, God can give you a second chance. So if you are here, you want to surrender your life to Jesus Christ. You too want to live a life that counts. The Bible says that the only thing that follows us when we die is our works. And we'll be judged when we get to heaven by two books. The book of life, if you have given your life to Jesus Christ, and the book of works. Everything that you've done, they will wait, they will ask questions. It's only the things that we do for God.
7 people died or thereabout in that plane. We're sure that all of them are with the Lord right now. How about you? Ask yourself that question. If I die tonight, will I make it to heaven? Well, that answer can be yes if you surrender your life to Jesus Christ. So are you here? You want to give your life to Jesus Christ? Just lift up your hands and we'll pray with you. Or you can't even remember that you have done it before. Or you have done it before and you fell back into sin. This is the time for you to lift up your hands. We'll pray a simple prayer with you and heaven will be guaranteed. Anybody, are you here? Lift up your hands, we'll pray with you. Anybody, this is the last call. This is the last call. This is the last call. Amen. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we want to thank you. We bless your holy name. We give you glory, honor, and adoration. We thank you, Lord, that we are here gathered to celebrate the life of your son and your daughter. Father, we thank you, Lord, for the great and awesome impact that his life even made in our lives. We thank you for allowing him to be used to transform nations. Father, even in death, he speaks. You have said that those that die in the Lord never die. Father, we thank you. We give you glory. We give you honor. We give you adoration. We pray that we'll learn lessons even from all that we have seen and had tonight. That our lives will be transformed for the better. That we'll live lives of impact. That you deposit in our hearts that what really matters at the end of it all is not how many houses we have built, what we have in our bank accounts, what cars we ride, but what have we done for the Lord. Father, we give you all the glory. We give you all the honor. In Jesus' mighty name we are praying. Amen.
Let's give the Lord a round of applause. Thank you, Pastor, for that homily. The Lord will continue to uphold you and strengthen you in the mighty name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. We believe that Dr. Myles and Pastor Ruth have gone to join the cloud of witnesses. Even though we do not have all the answers, but one thing we know is that God is good. God is good.
God is good all the time. He put a song of praise in this heart of mine. God is good all the time. Through the darkest night, his light will shine. God is good. God is good all the time.
Say, God is good all the time.
Through the darkest night, his light will shine.
God is good.
Yeah.
God is good all the time.
Sing it again. Say, God is good.
God is good
all the time.
All the time.
You put a song of praise in this heart of mine.
God is good.
Yes.
All the time.
Through the darkest night, light will shine.
God is good. God is good all the time.
If you're walking through the valley, there are shadows all around. Do not fear. He will guide you. He will keep you safe and sound. For he has promised to never leave you nor forsake you, and his word is true.
God is good.
Yes,
all the time.
You put a song of praise in this heart of mine.
God is good
all the time.
All the time.
Through the darkest night, his light will shine.
God is good.
Yes, sir.
God is good
all the time.
All the time.
One more time, everybody, say, God is good.
God is good all the time.
You put a song of praise in this heart of mine.
God is good.
darkest night, His light will shine.
God is good. God is good all the time.
Though I may not understand all the plans you have for me. Everybody sing. My life is in your hands. So through the eyes of faith, I can boldly say,
God is good.
Yes, sir.
All the time.
But a song God raised in this heart of mine.
God is good.
All the time.
All the time.
Oh, through the darkest night, His light will shine.
God is good. God is good.
Yes.
All the time.
Though I may not understand all the plans you have for me. Let's sing it, everybody. My life is in your hand. So through the eyes of faith, I can boldly say,
God is good.
Hey.
All the time.
You put a song of praise in this heart of mine.
God is good. All the time.
Through the darkest night, His light will shine.
God is good. God is good.
He's so good.
God is good.
He's so good. God is good.
God is good.
He's so good.
He's so good.
God is good.
God is good.
He's so all the time.
All the time.
God is good. All the time. Amen. No doubt, our brethren, Dr. Myles and Pastor Ruth, are singing with the angels.
Thank you.
Let's give the Lord, the Lord, the Lord, the Lord, the Lord, the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords, the I am that I am. Let's appreciate him. Amen. You may please be seated in God's presence. I couldn't help but think about the writer of that song, Ayobankole, and wondered how he would have received that if he was alive today. Amen. That was good. God bless you, voices in Zion. Amen. Next, we want to take a prayer for the family and to take this segment. I'd like to call on Pastor Remy Morgan to please come and let's pray for the Munroe family.
Praise the Lord. Shall we rise to our feet, please? Hallelujah. Father, we give you praise. Indeed, you are worthy and there is no one like you. Lord, we thank you that we can gather together this evening, Lord, to pay our tributes and share the memories of your son and your daughter that you have called to be with you. Lord, we want to thank you for the lives that they lived while they were here on the face of the earth. We want to thank you for years of significance. We want to thank you for years of impact. We want to thank you for years within which they fulfilled your purposes in their generation. We say to you, be all the glory in the name of Jesus Christ. Lord, we want to thank you for the inspiration that their lives have provided. We want to thank you for the very humble beginnings from which you brought your son, and you made him to sit with kings and princes, ministering and providing counsel and advice to the highest echelons of government right throughout the world. We want to thank you because through his life, we receive an understanding that indeed with you, nothing shall be impossible. Lord, we want to thank you for the life that he lived while he was here on the face of the earth. We want to thank you, Lord, for putting your son and your daughter to use to minister, to provoke, to challenge so many people into the place of their destinies. Lord, we that were beneficiaries or are beneficiaries of every utterance that came forth from their lips, of every word, every line that was written, Lord, I pray that you will continue to provoke our own lives also so that indeed we will fulfill purpose and we shall not die empty in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Lord, at this time we want to lift up their surviving children unto you. All the time while he lived on the face of the earth, Dr. Myles had spoken about the place of succession. Lord, I thank you for the opportunity that you gave his children to have been mentored by him, O God. And Lord, it is my prayer that in the midst of all that they are going through, Lord, you will comfort them in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Not only would you provide comfort, but you will provide inspiration, Lord, so that indeed they shall be greater than their parents in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Lord, we want to lift up the congregation of his church and of their church. We want to lift up the nation of the Bahamas. We want to lift up so many people that have made contact with him that have been blessed by his association. I ask my Lord and my God that you will comfort all who mourn in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. The Bible says we should not sorrow as those who have no hope, that if we believe that Jesus Christ died and rose again from the dead, then even people like Dr. Myles and his wife who have died in the Lord are only asleep. And Lord, when indeed you shall return with the sound of the archangel and with the trump of God, Bible says those who are asleep in you shall be the first to arise. And that which we are alive shall be caught up together to dwell in the clouds with them in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Lord, even as we consider the home calling and the transition of your son and your daughter, I pray, my Lord and my God, that even as the psalmist challenges us, that you will teach us to number our days, that we might apply our hearts unto wisdom in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Bible says it is appointed unto every man to die and then thereafter judgment. I pray, my Lord and my God, that when we are faced before the judgment throne, that our word and your word to each and every one of us shall be, well done, good and faithful servant. Enter thou into the rest of thy Lord. Lord, I pray, my Lord and my God, that you will order our steps in you aright in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. And that, Lord, in this time, you will permit us to lift up our eyes even to the hills and obtain strength and draw strength from that in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Lord, the Bible tells us in the book of Isaiah that it was in the year that King Uzziah died that Isaiah saw the Lord. Hitherto he had been ministering as a prophet, but something happened, and when the king was taken away from him, he saw you with greater clarity. Lord, I pray that at this time, in the name of Jesus, that each and every one of us that are alive, oh God, will see you with greater clarity, understand our purpose with greater clarity, in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Lord, once again, we celebrate the life of an awesome individual. We celebrate the life of his wife. And we take comfort that even though he physically is not here with us, his words continue to resound in our hearts and in our lives in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Father, once again, we say we commit him. We commit his wife. We commit their souls into your hands in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. And until that day when we shall meet to part no more, until that glorious resurrection morning, my Lord and my God, when we shall meet to part no more, that you will keep each and every one of us in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Thank you for the life that we have received in you. Lord, I pray that even as our hands are on the plow, there shall never be any reason to look back in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. And concerning each and every one of us, it shall be forward and backward never in the name of Jesus. By your grace and your mercy, it shall be upward always and downwards never in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Father, we lift them up unto you, and we lift up everyone, oh God, who has benefited from whatever it is that they have shared. Particularly, we lift up those in government. We thank you that, Lord, even at this time, the things that he has shared with them will be resounding in their hearts and in their spirits in the name of Jesus. At this time when the nation needs proper and godly leadership, you will stir up everything that he has deposited in their hearts in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. That concerning Nigeria, we will hear a new song. We will sing a new song in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. That those songs of despair and songs of woe will be converted to songs of rejoicing concerning what you will do in our leadership in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Father, we give you praise. We bless your holy name. In Jesus' mighty name we pray.
After all said and done, the most important thing is to make heaven.
Just one thing that matters. Did I do my best to live for truth? Did I lay my life for you? When it's all been said and done, all my treasures will mean nothing. Only what I have done for love's reward will stand the test of time. Yes, Lord. you look beyond all weakness. You found pure as gold in miry clay, turning sinners into saints. Oh, I will always sing your praise here on earth and heaven after. You have shown me heaven, my true home, when it's all been said and done. You're my life when life is gone. When it's all been said and done. You're my life when life is gone.
No doubt this is a celebration of a life of purpose for both Dr. Myles and his dearly beloved Pastor Ruth. Amen. For your information, there will be a service of song going on also in Bahamas later today. We are some hours ahead of them. And tomorrow will be the final interning of Dr. Myles and Pastor Ruth. And so, we shall continue in attitude of prayer, but more importantly, praise, and thanking God for the privilege that each and every one of us had in coming in contact with them and the impact they made in our lives. Well, we've come to the end of our tribute service, but to take us in the closing prayer and benediction, please join me as I welcome Pastor Shiju Iliomade.
Shall we write? Angels of heaven, angels of God, are walking and welcoming home our brother, Myles, and our dear sister, Ruth Munroe. Lord, we thank you for their beautiful life. We thank you that now the pilgrim's journey is over. But we thank you that they rang the strong, a steadfast, and a faithful race. We thank you that their lives were not wasted. We thank you, Almighty God, that it pleased you to call them home united. We thank you that whenever Myles Munroe shall be mentioned, so also shall the name of Ruth Munroe be mentioned. We thank you, Lord, that the children will be inspired by the life of their parents. We thank you for the Church of God, because the gates of hell will not prevail against it. And therefore, because we know that you are God, and you are God forevermore, we declare this evening that the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the sweet fellowship of the Holy Spirit will keep us and unite us even as one, marching forward, knowing and believing that Christ is the Lord of our lives. Father, therefore, we join hands in fellowship and we say the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the sweet fellowship of the Holy Spirit be upon you forevermore. Surely.